April 27th is the anniversary of one of the worst tornado outbreaks ever across East Tennessee and Southwest Virginia. For those of us at the National Weather Service in Morristown, Tennessee, it was certainly a day to remember. We issued 71 tornado warnings that day for our area, with 60 confirmed tornadoes. There were 35 fatalities that day from the tornadoes, with nearly 300 injuries reported. Here are all the reports of tornadoes, hail, and wind damage across the country for April 27, 2011. This storm system was a multi-day severe weather event that started across the central plains and gradually worked its way east, producing severe weather from Louisiana all the way to upstate New York. Here is a map showing the tornado tracks across our county warning area on April 27, 2011. There are many overlapping tracks, so not all of the tornado tracks show up here on this map. You can follow the link at the top of the slide if you wish to see an interactive map. These slides show the Storm Prediction Center's convective outlook for April 27, 2011. The top left slide shows the categorical outlook, with our entire area being included in the moderate risk area, while the southern Tennessee Valley was included in the high-risk area. Moderate risks for our area aren't unheard of, but high-risk days are very rare. The bottom right slide shows the tornado probability for the day. The 30% area extends into the southern Tennessee Valley and the Chattanooga area. All of our area is under at least the 10% area. The actual percentages are the probability of a tornado occurring within 25 miles of a point. The hatched area means that there is a 10% or greater probability of EF2 to EF5 tornadoes within 25 miles of a point. As you can see, the hatched area covered a large part of our area, meaning that strong tornadoes were possible this day. What were the conditions that made April 27th so favorable for tornadoes? Let's take a quick look at some of the ingredients that came together that day. East Tennessee is located at the Yellow Star. Let's start at 8 o'clock in the morning on April 27th. High up in the atmosphere at 300 millibars, a deep trough was quickly approaching our area with strong jet stream winds near the bottom of the trough and also near the Great Lakes. This jet pattern creates diverging winds aloft, which helps thunderstorms to grow quickly and efficiently. As we move lower in the atmosphere to 500 millibars, we see the wind field remain strong due to the same deep trough. Moving lower to 850 millibars, a strong southerly low-level flow helped to transport plenty of moisture from the Gulf of Mexico into our area throughout the day, providing a ripe environment for thunderstorms. Warm, moist air in the low levels of the atmosphere provides energy for storms to grow and intensify. At the surface, we see a low-pressure system over western Tennessee and western Kentucky, with a cold front stretching along the Mississippi River. These features would continue moving east through the day, triggering the development of thunderstorms along and ahead of the front. These are some different parameters that we use to determine the threat of severe weather. From these, we see that conditions were primed for severe weather, with values that could support rotating supercell storms. The top left slide shows wind shear through a deep layer in the atmosphere. Deep wind shear is an important ingredient to support rotating supercell storms that can produce tornadoes. Supercells are commonly associated with wind shear values of 30 to 40 knots and greater. On April 27th, we had 60 to 70 knots of wind shear across our area. The top right slide displays mixed layer convective available potential energy, or CAPE. CAPE is the amount of energy available to a thunderstorm. Though values weren't overly high on this day across East Tennessee, they were high enough to support severe weather, with values of 500 to 1,000. The bottom left slide displays the supercell composite parameter. Values of SCP higher than 1 correspond to environments that are favorable for supercells. On this day, SCP values were extremely high, 10 or higher across most of the area, and up to 20 across the southern valley. The bottom right slide displays the significant tornado parameter. A majority of significant tornadoes producing EF2 or greater damage have been associated with STP values greater than 1. A large majority of our area had values of 3 and higher, while closer to Chattanooga, values were approaching 6. We'll take a closer look at a few of the tornadoes from April 27th, but first, let's take a look at how tornadoes are rated. After a tornado occurs, teams from the National Weather Service travel to survey the damaged site. Based on the level of damage, the tornado is given a rating on a scale from 0 to 5, called the Enhanced Fujita Scale. Numerous scientific studies have been performed to estimate the wind speeds that can cause a certain level of damage. So the EF scale is a way to correlate tornado damage with wind speed. Now let's take a closer look at some of the most significant tornadoes from April 27th. The Collegedale tornado occurred on the evening of the 27th. It was a continuation of a tornado that had produced major damage in Ringgold, Georgia. This EF4 tornado, with maximum winds estimated at 190 miles an hour, produced a damaged path 37 miles long, affecting Hamilton, Bradley, Polk, and McMinn counties. The greatest damage was in the Collegedale and Appison communities east of Chattanooga. In this area, some homes were swept off their foundations, cars were overturned, and high-tension power line poles were bent to the ground. 13 fatalities and over 200 injuries were attributed to this tornado. This is what the Collegedale storm looked like from our radar. The upper left image of reflectivity shows a signature of a supercell storm, what we call a hook echo, circled in white. This forms from rain being wrapped around the back of the storm due to the rotating winds. The lower right image shows the velocity of the winds measured by radar. The bright green to blue colors show very strong winds moving toward the radar, and the bright red colors indicate strong winds moving away from the radar. When we see bright red against bright green or blue, as we see here in the circle, this is a sign of the rotating winds that can cause a tornado. This particular storm was far away from our radar, so the rotating winds that we're seeing here are not actually from the tornado. We're seeing the rotation higher in the storm, which sometimes can lead to a tornado at the ground. This is called a mesocyclone. The same supercell storm that produced the Collegedale tornado continued to produce tornadoes as it tracked northeast through the Tennessee Valley. One of the more significant of these tornadoes was in Camp Creek, Tennessee, in Greene County. It was rated an EF3 tornado as it moved through Camp Creek, with maximum estimated wind speeds of 150 miles an hour. There were 6 fatalities and 33 injuries reported in Greene and Washington counties. Since our radar in Morristown isn't too far away from Camp Creek, we were able to get an excellent radar view of the tornado. The counterclockwise spin within the storm can be seen in the reflectivity pattern on the left. The velocity image on the right showed a couplet of pink right against blue, indicating the very strong rotating winds of the tornado. An EF4 tornado with winds estimated at 180 miles an hour formed near Dunlap in Sequatchie County, tracked northeast through Bledsoe County, and ended near Spring City in Ray County, a path length of nearly 40 miles. The greatest damage occurred in the community of New Harmony in Bledsoe County, located at the top of Walden Ridge. The tornado moved from the Sequatchie Valley across Walden Ridge and into the Tennessee Valley, disproving the myth that strong tornadoes cannot occur in rugged terrain. There were 4 fatalities and 10 injuries reported with this tornado. The Glade Spring tornado occurred after midnight on April 28th. It began in southern Washington County, Virginia, just east of the city of Bristol. The tornado intensified as it moved northeast, reaching peak strength near the time that it crossed Interstate 81 at exit 29, near Glade Spring, Virginia. It left a path of damage about 3/4 of a mile wide. As the tornado crossed Interstate 81 at exit 29, it hit a travel station, overturning several tractor trailers. Some trailers were tossed across the highway. Several other homes and businesses in this area sustained significant damage. 3 fatalities and 50 injuries occurred with this tornado in Washington County, Virginia. The April 27th tornado outbreak is a solemn reminder of the need to take action to protect yourself when tornadoes threaten your location. Many more lives could have been lost that day if people had not heeded warnings and had not prepared in advance to move to a safe place. Having a plan of action can save your life. Plan ahead where you would take shelter if a tornado was approaching. Have a reliable source of weather information to get the latest warnings, such as a NOAA weather radio. When a warning is issued, move to your predetermined shelter. The best locations are a basement or underground shelter. If those are not available, go to a small interior room on the lowest level of the building. The idea is to put as many walls between you and the tornado as possible. This can help protect you from flying debris, which is the greatest danger in a tornado. Mobile homes are never a safe option during a tornado. Over half of all tornado deaths each year occur in mobile homes. Leave your mobile home well in advance of the approaching severe weather and go to a strong building. If there is no shelter nearby, lie flat in the nearest ditch and try to cover yourself as much as possible. A vehicle is not a safe place to be in a tornado. The first option should always be to seek a sturdy shelter. If you can see the tornado and determine its direction of movement, drive at right angles to its path. If the tornado is bearing down on you and no shelter is available, park out of traffic lanes and stay in your vehicle with the seatbelt on. Get as low as possible below the windows and cover your head. Bridges and overpasses are not safe shelters, as they do not provide protection from flying debris. Finally, here is a loop of the entire event from the radar located here in Morristown, Tennessee. The first wave of storms approached our plateau counties around 8 a.m., and this line of storms contained several tornadoes. There was a break in activity during the afternoon hours, but the next round of storms moved in around 3 p.m. and lasted well past midnight. April 27, 2011 was a day that many of us in East Tennessee and Southwest Virginia will never forget. Thank you for watching.